Hi everyone, it's Niamh here again, talking to you about all things space, because that's what I'm obsessed about, so I may as well tell you about it. I want to talk today about our European Space Agency astronaut, Thomas Pesquet, who will be launching to the International Space Station on Earth Day. Thomas is making some historic firsts for Europe. He's the first European astronaut to be launching from America at Cape Canaveral since the space shuttle was retired, which was back in 2011, so that's 10 years ago. So, because of course, before this, he would have been launching from Baikonur, where he launched it for his previous mission, Proxima. This Alpha mission is another first because Thomas will be launching with his crewmates, two NASA astronauts, Megan McArthur and Shane Kimbrough, and Japanese Space Agency astronaut Akihiko, and they're launching on the SpaceX Falcon 9 reusable rocket on the Crew Dragon luxury spacecraft. Thomas is a French astronaut, and this is his second mission to the International Space Station. He was up there previously in 2016, and I got to talk to him while he was in quarantine at NASA. So have a listen to the interview.
Hello.
How are you?
Hey, I'm good. Thank you. How are you? Feeling good. There's some last minute preparation still ongoing. We've done the most of, like, the biggest chunk of the work is done. Now there's some small errands to run here and there. We're trying to stay current. We're in the sim every day. We're in the gym every day, but it's mostly like fine tuning everything, and then we'll be ready on time on the 22nd.
Mm-hmm. Have you been based more in the US this time at SpaceX, or how did they prepare you for this spacecraft compared to the Soyuz of the last one?
Yeah, it really was a combination of things, and everything related to the capsule and the flight up to the space station and back has been trained at SpaceX in California, which was pretty nice, actually, going there. They have nice facilities, all the simulators, very young people, very dynamic, so it was a lot of fun. Everything space station, where we're going to stay for 6 months, is still based in Houston with NASA, and also with the partners all across the world. There was less traveling, though, because of COVID, obviously, we had to do things differently. So we did a lot of remote training. We kind of cut everything that was not strictly mandatory. And we had to adapt to the situation, just like so many other people across the board.
How do you think your launch and return is going to be different in the Crew Dragon in comparison to the Soyuz space?
Number one difference is I have room for my legs, because the Soyuz capsule is actually, it's not bad at all, because it's really, there's two volumes. Yeah. There's that small volume where we sit, but you're really crammed in there, three crew members, and I'm not very flexible. So that was painful for my knees just to stay in that position for hours and hours. But then once you get to orbit, you can transition between those two volumes, which is actually pretty neat, because you can have, you know, your lunch or go to the bathroom in one of the two volumes, and then have some privacy. SpaceX is different. It's a big volume, so lots of room, but everything happens in the cabin, so there's not much privacy. Still good, because we don't even take 24 hours. It doesn't even take 24 hours to get to the space station. But it's also much more automated, right? It's a big flat screen. The information is really nicely displayed for your situation awareness as a pilot. You don't have to make sense of 100, you know, dials and gauges to know what's going on. The spacecraft basically tells you, this is what's going on. Pay attention to this, and you just have to let yourself be guided.
And you're going up there to a pretty crowded space station as well.
Yeah, three of them shouldn't come down. And then once we go up, there will be 11 for a period of time. They're supposed to stay for 5 days. And the reason we're doing this, and we want to do indirect handover, which is to bring the new people up before we bring the old people, the ones finishing their missions, down. And we used to do differently before. Now for a period of time, because the technology is not yet so mature, we're going to do this. But so for 5 days, we'll be 11. And then the previous Crew Dragon crew is going to come down, and then it's going to be down to one Soyuz crew, three of them, and one Crew Dragon crew. Hours, four of us, will be 7 for most of the mission.
What's success to you about Alpha, your mission Alpha? What would you really like to see achieved as part of that?
Yeah, I think we have a really packed schedule, both on the operations logistics side. We're supposed to go out and install new solar arrays on the space station. The space station is getting bigger. There's more and more equipment. Mm-hmm. The solar array are degrading. They've been up there for 15 years for the oldest part. So we need to renew this, to upgrade this. So we're going to go out and install 750 pounds solar array outside the space station, which is going to be crazy. So all this, if we manage to make all this happen nominally without, mishap without with everything working, that'd be great. The other, of course, the other big success criteria is all the science that we're going to have to perform on board the space station, all the experiments, whether it be from NASA or from ESA, from other partners. There's a packed schedule of, I think, more than 200 experiments for our increment. Mm-hmm. So if we manage to get all that done, then we'll consider the mission a success.
And how do you feel, Thomas, about being the first European to get the opportunity to fly in Crew Dragon and also to launch again from the United States after a 10-year hiatus?
I think it's great. I mean, I quite frankly, I can't take the credit for that because I was just at the right place at the right time, right? Okay. But it feels great. It's what I really like is to have had the opportunity to fly in Soyuz and now flying on a different vehicle. Yeah. If you're asking me, that's what's most interesting about our program, because you try to pick the best, you know, from every culture, from every way of doing things. And then now when I fly on Dragon, I recognize what's good, what's better than on the Soyuz, but I also recognize, you know, that just the reliability of the Soyuz. And sometimes things were also really well designed on the Soyuz, even though it's old technology.
Yeah.
So being able to have this, you know, this step back and compare the two systems, it's so comfortable for an astronaut that I'm really happy to have had the opportunity to go.
Yeah. You've been working together for a fairly long period of time, I guess, to prepare together as crew.
It's a lot of time together, but quite frankly, because of COVID also, it was more, maybe some more time by myself than I would like to and that I care to. And also, you know, before flying on the Soyuz, the crews would travel to Russia and to Star City, to the cosmonaut training center, for extended periods of time, like for 5 weeks at a time, you know, every 10 weeks. Like, I spent more than 50% of my time. So we ended up staying together, like having dinner, making food, preparing food and talking and chatting over dinner. So it was just the best way to get to know your crewmates, which was to hang out in Russia. And unfortunately, it didn't happen this time. So like you said, it's good because most of them I know from before.
That's good.
Which is great. But other than that, I wish I had had more time with them, like go put ourselves in difficult situations, do some survival training, do some, you know, underwater training, do some mountaineering, some caving, it doesn't matter. But that's how you really get to know your crew members and your crewmates, is by going through this as a team.
Did you work with a chef this time again for your special food items?
So there's actually three chefs this time, because if I don't want to be stripped of my French citizenship, I have to, and my crewmates are already waiting. They're like, so what
exactly,
you know, what delicacies are you going to bring up? I was like, hey, wait a minute, I'm working on it. But no, there was Alain Ducasse. He's always prepared food since the very beginning for the French missions, and then it got extended to the European missions. So now everybody can just pick food from Alain Ducasse. So anybody, and the Russians do it a lot, actually. I was surprised to find a lot of French food up there on the Russian side. There was Thierry Marx, who's a chef that I met before my previous flight, who prepared some dishes for me. He did it again this time. And then the new one this time is, actually, I went to the catering company for Air France, because I used to be an airline pilot for them. So I was used to, you know, having their food on board as a pilot, and sometimes as a passenger. And it's in their skill set to prepare food that's designed to be eaten from a can, you know, in a completely different environment. So they've been really, really good. They worked with a lot of different chefs in France. And for everything that was packaging and really the whole logistic chain, they've done a fantastic work. So I'll have plenty to choose from.
Artistically, I know the last time you performed on the International Space Station, and you also had that lovely documentary, you worked with them on 16 Sunrises. Have you any art outreach going on this time? Are you playing your saxophone or anything again this time?
Yeah, I'm going to play my saxophone.
Brilliant.
Yeah. There's no real... we didn't have a documentary project, because those documentaries, we had a couple that those guys have actually been following me. They had been following me all along, like from 2 years before the flight, going through all the training. That was not possible this time because of COVID. Mm. So unfortunately, we couldn't start anything. I'll film some scenes. I'll make some short clips. Maybe we can compile everything into something good, a good product at the end of the mission. But also maybe this time I still want to share the mission, but I also take some more time for myself maybe. Yeah. The first mission, I always had a constant list of, you know, things to do and pictures to take and shots to make and videos to film, etc. And that just never ended for 200 days. This time I want to have maybe some time, some more selfish quiet time for myself, just look out the window and have nothing to do.
The astronaut selection call has been made and we have a closing date of the 28th of May, and we're encouraging as many young Irish scientists and engineers. Absolutely. You know, what fundamental advice would you give to people who may feel that they don't have enough qualifications or they're not good enough?
I think the first and foremost, they have to apply. People have to apply. I almost didn't apply last time because my mind at the time, because it's, to me, astronauts were superheroes. Yeah. And you know, and a friend of mine, I had to tell me, hey, look, you're a pilot, you're an aerospace engineer, you're doing a lot of sports. I was like, hey, he's right, maybe I have my chances. But even when I started off, I was not convinced. There's 10,000 of us, so it would have been very arrogant to think I was going to be among the last six or five. But I think the proper attitude and what I did wrong is just try. You go out there, it's free. You know, sign up, do your best, try to find some information and take things one at a time. Because really, there's going to be some people with six PhDs. There's going to be some very good athletes. But more often than not, those very few people actually combine all the skills. And for being an astronaut, you don't have to be excellent in one domain. You have to be okay in a lot of domains. Like if you have six PhDs, but you're not a good athlete, then you're not going to make it. If you speak six foreign languages, but you can't run on a treadmill, you're not going to make it. So don't compare yourself to others, because you're going to see all the good things. You're not going to see what they're missing. And everybody is missing something. Very few people, very few individuals at the end have the required amount in all the domains. And that doesn't make them super people. It's just being normal in a lot of different domains. So sign up. And you know, try it. You never know.
Thomas, we'll be watching. We wish you all the best.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And I hope to talk to you and come to Ireland after the flight. It'd be lovely.
We'd love that. Slán agus gurma hagat. Bye.
Oh, exactly. Yes, like you said. I learned that for after the flight. I will learn tomorrow.